Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for your manifest presence in this place. We give you all the glory, we give you all the praise, for you are set in our midst to work miracles, to stretch forth your hand for signs and wonders to happen. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. All right, maybe say that quickly. Amen. All right. Today, please, there is a feedback in that place. Huh? Amen. All right. While I was praying about this meeting, God said, look, let this first night be a communion and healing service. Now, Dr. Roberts' teaching talked about, I believe he's the first person that said this, for the best of my knowledge, that there is something that is called the point of contact with God's power. And that's the law of contact and transmission. That every form of power on this earth has a point where you make contact with it. In other words, power can be in this building, but this entire place can still be dark until you go to the switch. The switch there is the point where you make contact with that power. And when you put on the switch, the light comes on. And in the ministry of Jesus, he identified 5 points of contact. First one was the spoken word of God. In other words, that was the point of contact. And people determined their point of contact. The woman with the issue of blood determined her point of contact. She said, if I will just touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. That was her point, the point where she made contact, all right, with the power of God, and by the law of transmission, it entered into her. The Roman centurion, put me on 30 minutes, all right? Not 40, but 30, all right. The Roman centurion had first of all said his point of contact. Go and meet him and ask him to come to my house that he might lay hands on my servant. While Jesus was on the way, he changed the point of contact. He said, speak the word only. He didn't change the source of it. He changed the point at which he was going to make contact with that power. You had them take handkerchiefs, put them there on the body, all right, of Peter, and it was taken up, or Paul, and it was taken, all right, there. So that was the point of contact. The anointing oil is a point. It says you will anoint the sick with oil. That's the point of contact. You can use the anointing oil as a point of contact. Laying on of hands as a point of contact. The spoken word, all right, as a point of contact. And one of the points of contact in the New Testament is the communion. It is a point at which you can make contact with the power of God, that there is a transmission that actually occurs. And I just want to share briefly here about this point of contact. Now, Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 29 and verse 30, he said, for he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, he was talking about the communion, eateth and drinketh damnation unto himself, not discerning the Lord's body. And what was the result? For this cause, many are what? Weak. Many are sickly. Not just some. I mean, they were very careless about things in that church. And he said, many, all right, do sleep. So it was a point of contact. But you know, you can say, there is power, there is a point of contact. If you go with your bare hands, you will know for this cause. Are you following what I'm saying here? Once you put on light in the place, for that cause, you can be translated and you are with Jesus and you are talking with Jesus for this cause, because you handled the wire unworthily. You didn't respect the wire. So what it was supposed to do, it produced the opposite in your life. So let's look at this as a point of contact. Now, this communion here, let's cut long story short, first time Jesus did it was on the night of the Passover. And what used to happen was, on the Passover, they would all come together and eat the Passover. And Paul, who wasn't even there, said, all right, the day in which the Lord was betrayed, that which I received of the Lord declare I unto you, that in that particular day, and it was the day of the Passover, and God had told the children of Israel, this ordinance of eating the Passover will be kept throughout generations forever. If God says forever, it is what? Forever. So what we have is an upgrade now, because Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Now in Exodus chapter 12 and verse 3, one that night of the Passover, I want to show something. Exodus 12, 3. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of the month, you shall take every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for every house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let them take the neighbor's own. All right. According to his saying, you shall make count for the lamb. Verse 5. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male, all right, you take it out from the sheep. Verse 6. And you shall keep it up until the 14th day, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. Verse 7. And they shall take the blood. And we speak a lot about this one. All right? Now, remember it says they eateth and drinketh what? Unworthily. Now, many people understand the worth of the blood, but haven't yet seen what the body was about. When Jesus died on the cross, not only did he shed his blood, he offered up his body. So there were two sacrifices he made there. One, the shedding of his blood. The second was the offering up of his body unto God. And he says here, you will kill the lamb and you will sprinkle the blood upon the two side posts, upper post of the houses where you shall eat it. Verse 8, and they shall eat the flesh in that night, roasted with fire, with unleavened bread, bitter herbs. They shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden with water, but roasted with fire. And he talked about how they will eat it. Verse 10. And you shall not let nothing of it remain until morning. And that which remain in the morning, you shall burn with fire. And thus shall you eat it, with your loins gathered, your shields on your feet, and you shall eat it in haste, for it is the Lord's Passover. And when I pass through the land, I will smite the firstborn of the land of Egypt, both man and beast, against the gods of Egypt, will I execute judgment, I am the Lord. Verse 13. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon your house, that when I see the blood, so the instruction was, you must kill the lamb, you must apply the blood to the doorpost, because when I see the blood, not when you kill the lamb. Do you get what I'm saying here? So if you kill the lamb and you didn't apply the blood, the angel of death will come in. The reason why the angel of death won't come in is because he says you have applied the blood, all right, to the doorpost there. Put it back up there. He says, when I see the blood, I will pass over and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you. Now, so here is the issue. If you didn't apply the blood, then the plague got in, the angel of death. But you could have applied the blood and not eaten the sacrifice. That angel of death will still have passed. Because what he said was, if I see the blood, I will do what? Passover. But he gave them two instructions. Eat the flesh and apply the blood. Now, what was the flesh for? How are we going to know you didn't eat the flesh? He said, apply the blood. So which means was going, he saw the blood. If you ate the flesh and you didn't apply the blood, it was coming to take you out. But what if you apply the blood there, but he eats the flesh there? What happens? Now, I hope you know the people that left Egypt were about 3 million. They were very young people, babies, 100-year-old people. Are you telling me that 100 all kinds of people, and they were going to walk in the desert? The Bible says there was not one feeble person among them. Great-grandmothers walked that journey. Grandfathers walked that journey. Children walked that journey. Everybody had strength. Where did that strength come from? It came from the lamb they ate. If you didn't eat that lamb and you started that journey, they would have seen you didn't eat this lamb. And I'll show you from scripture. I will prove it. That if you didn't eat the flesh and you apply the blood, the angel of death will pass, but you'll be revealed in the wilderness once the journey starts. Those people had stamina to walk miles. How can you tell me that everybody was perfect? Are you telling me there was nobody there? You didn't have anybody that was saying, let's go. Every Bible says, not one feeble person among them. It is what they ate that gave them strength. You say, how do you know? Let me show you. Go to 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 5. This was just after Elijah said, I'm going to take my life when, what's her name now? Jezebel said, I will get you. And as he lay to sleep there and slept on a juniper tree, behold, an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and do what? Eat. That angel cooked. Look at the next verse. Listen, these are the dimensions God wants to bring the church into. What I'm going to share here. Angel cooked for Elijah. Look at this. Look at this. And he looked, behold, there was a cake baken on coals and a cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink, and he lay down to rest again. The angel came back again with another meal. Look at this. And he came again a second time, touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. Look at what happened. He arose and did eat and drink and went in the strength of that meat alone. He didn't eat any other thing. 40 days and 40 nights on that meat. That meat was supernatural. What they ate of that lamb was what kept those people. Are you following me? If you don't discern that body, that meat, listen, if I eat of the flesh of Jesus, the condition of my body cannot deteriorate. Look, 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 listen. Psalm 78, verse 24 and 25. Psalm 78. Look. He rained down what? Manna from heaven. And giving them what? Corn, all right, of heaven. Look at where it came from. Man did eat what? Angels' food. And he sent them meat to the what? Food. So that manna was what? Angels' food. So let me show you. Deuteronomy chapter 8. When they ate it, look at what happened. Verse 3. Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 3. It says, he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not. Neither did thy fathers know, that you might know that man doesn't live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. Look at the effect of it. Thy raiment waxed not old upon thee, neither did thy foot swell, for what stopped their foot from swelling? What they ate. What kept their raiment this way? What they ate. Listen, church. God showed me. He said, I took that manna and put it in the holiest of all. I won't talk more than this. He said, I put shewbread in the outer court. It's the shewbread my people are eating. He said, most of what people are doing in church is shewbread meal. What did Paul say? He said, I fed you with milk. He said, not with. That means there are two diets. If we start eating manna, supernatural things will happen. That's why Jesus said, whosoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood has my life in him. See, this message, the truth is for another day. I just want to steer people up. Are you following me here? Let's stop this thing in church, that the message must just be very easy for us to. Do you get what I'm saying here? There are deeper things. There are things you can sit with in God's word, that when you feed on those things, when you feed on those things in God's word, he says they are raiment. It will affect you everywhere. 40 days and 40 nights, no other meal. He had the strength to do that. That's where they got it from. So, there's a distinction. I said this here. There is something that looks like manna, but it's not. It's shewbread. It's in the outer court. The manna is where? Inside. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 2 and verse 4. Verse 9, 2 to 4. He says, for there was a tabernacle made, the first, wherein was a candlestick and a table, and the what? Shewbread, which is called the sanctuary. Then, after the second veil, the tabernacle called the holiest of all, he says, which was had the golden censer, the ark of the covenant, overlaid round about gold, wherein was the golden pot that had what? Manna. Didn't you hear what Paul said? He said, having tasted of the heavenly gifts, he said, you are partakers of the good. Look, let me read it to you. All right? He says this here in Hebrews, all right? Hebrews there. 6, all right? For it is impossible for those who are once enlightened, who have tasted of the heavenly gifts, who are made partakers of the Holy Ghost. Now, what's that heavenly gift? He said, who have tasted of the good word, that's that rhema, is manna. He said, and the power of the ages to come. In other words, you are entering into what will come after, not in this time. Christianity is not a joke. Look, Jesus mixed it. He said in this way. He said, if you eat my flesh and drink my blood. When they looked at him, he said, your fathers were fed with manna, they died. He said, whosoever eateth this bread. He was calling his flesh there, that bread again. Now, let me close by just saying this, because there's a way in which you access manna, because it's in the holiest of all. See, when the Syrophoenician widow went to meet Jesus for healing, went to meet Jesus for healing, for her daughter. Put it up, Matthew 15, verse 22. This is why I've said this. Some of you may not remember. I said this here in Wavbeck. I said it. Maybe first time I taught on joy. I said that from what I have seen, it is the worshippers that will break through first globally, because Judah must go first. If you are not a worshiper and you're a preacher, you have no chance in what is coming. What you'll be dealing with is shewbread teaching. And once manna starts, everybody will know. Look at what he says. Where was I? Matthew 15. And behold, the woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried, saying, have mercy on me, Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word, a word. That word there is rhema. This is a one. And his disciples came. She shouted, this prayer now. Have mercy upon me, son of David. She was praying. He didn't answer her. Send her away, for she cried after us. And then she came, and the Bible says, and what? Worshipped. God cannot, even if there's no covenant, he can't deny worship. The worshiper must have access. Even if there is no blood covenant, the worshiper must do what? Have access. Listen, I played today that God, that Copeland was saying God is holding things back, holding back for his church. Don't come here and tell me it's only born again Christian. The Bible says whatsoever has breath can do what? Praise the Lord. If a sinner praises the Lord, God will respond to that person. Anything that has what? Breath. Anything that has breath can preach. Anything that has breath can do what? Praise the Lord. I hope you know when the cock crows in the morning, is praise. When the lion roars, is praise. Father, I worship you. Without you, no matter how strong I am, I won't find meat. I give you all the glory and praise for the opportunity you give me. You think it's just right there? Anything that has what? Breath. Anything that, the one that goes and doesn't find, go and read Psalms. It's because he didn't worship God in the morning. Go and read the Psalms, you see it. He says the young lions do what? Do lack. Which means it's not strength that makes you get it, it's worship. But it says those that seek the Lord shall not want any good thing. That means the young lion that finds sought the Lord. It is not for Pentecostals alone. You have no corner of heaven. There are no gatekeepers there. Didn't you hear what Jesus said? Sometimes he said we healed people. The Jews did not come back to thank him. It was the stranger. Now, what did he do to that woman when she worshipped? When Jesus answered her, he gave her the key. She came and worshipped, saying, help me. Now, Jesus did what? Next verse. He answered now. The last time he said, I'm not answering. This time he did what? He answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs. Look at what she said. She said, truth, Lord, yet dogs eat crumbs which fall from their master's table. From the crumbs she ate, her daughter got healed. If people are eating the bread of the children, how can they? Do you get what we are saying? We are not eating the bread. And how do you get to the bread? Is worship. What is worship here? You went to meet Jesus. He was walking. And you say, Lord, have mercy upon me. And he behaves like he didn't see you, yet you worshipped. Your prayer went unanswered, but you worshipped. Do you get what I'm saying here? Your prayer did not answer, you worshipped. They did the promotion, they missed your name, you worshipped. It's people like that that get the manna. Those are the true worshippers. Can you say somebody is your friend? Anytime the person comes, you give the person something, the person comes, you give the person. The day you now don't give, the person is grumbling. What will you say? You say, so, you are, this is just a transactional thing. Because Jesus loved Lazarus, go and read it. Because he loved them, he stayed still when they prayed for him to come, because he loved them. He didn't go because he did what? Love them. Are you hearing what I'm saying here? Because he loved, he said they can handle this. If they see me, they won't be angry. I've said this. God tests. Is Satan that tempts, but God tests. Satan tempts. God tests. If he tells you test every spirit, he's testing you too. Are you following what I'm saying here? He gave you a test. This is why I've said this. In all of my life as a Christian leader, I have never seen anybody who was disappointed and went back home to worship as though God met that need, that something bigger did not come. I have never seen anybody. In our church in Port Harcourt, I saw a lady. She said, Pastor, what you said is correct. What you said is correct. And I heard people say it. You said, your first response means everything. Your first response. Once something goes wrong, your first response. You keep saying first response. He says, what you do in the first 1 minute will count. He said, when I got burnt, I remembered it and I began to thank God. I looked at her. Where is the burn? She said, listen, God healed me. Can you imagine someone getting burnt and his worship coming out? First time I preached joy here, God told me, he said, I miss David on the earth. He said, David is a man that you can take everything away from, he will return worship back to you. His child died, he hits me with worship. I'm the one that judged him and said, your child is going to die. Not that the child died, I said, you will die. After the child died, he came back and said, okay, you have killed the child, here is worship now. He said, what do you do to that kind of person? Whatever you have, you give the person. If we want to get to the golden pot that has manna, look, there are some things God gives because he loves you.
but there are some things he gives because you love him. Let's not overstretch the message. He causes rain to fall on anybody, but he says, don't give your pearls to the swine, neither cast holy things to dogs. He can't give a holy thing to an ungrateful person. And who did he say are dogs there? Paul told us. He said, whose God is their belly? In other words, once the thing doesn't sit right with him, he says, we are true worshipers who have been circumcised in the spirit, which means we have bled in our hearts, we are worshiping. As ministers, please, let's not raise spoiled Christians because we want to fill our congregation. Because let me tell you what is going to happen. Write what I'm saying down. It will be mysterious. You have a church with 20,000 people. You have a church with 1,000 people. That 1,000 people will have more impact on the society than 20,000. And you'll be wondering how they have that voice, how they have that authority, how they have that influence. How come 50% of the people inside that church have influence in the society and all of that, and you pack 20,000 people who are spoiled? And there's nothing like maintaining people who, when they look at you, you must change your message. Are you following what I'm saying? So let me just land, because I have to land this on communion. Abby? Let me just land. The quietness has shown me the point has been made. But if you eat a meal cooked from heaven, it will sustain you. If you eat bread, it says the child there was healed. If you eat those things, do you know what will happen? Daniel said, we are not eating this. They were eating something else. They were found to have 10 times more understanding. John chapter 6, verse 54 and 58 here. So listen, as we partake of these two here, because as we were worshiping, I wrote it down, God told me, said, listen. He said, as they partake of my blood, let them know that today, any mistake that they made in the past that is affecting them is canceled. Are you following what I'm saying here? That it is permanently purged. Nobody on this earth will see you again and ask you any question about that mistake. You say, well, I had a child out of wedlock when I was young. The man that is coming will not discuss it with you. Are you following, sir? He will receive you and the child together as his. He won't open his mouth and say it. You say, well, they sacked me from an office because of financial misappropriation and all that. The next place he opens the door, nobody will ask you. When you say, are you following what I'm saying here? He says, he has taken the ordinances against you, nailed it to the cross, and wiped everything out of your slate. And if you have any condition in your body as you partake of this, this is point of contact. But we'll talk about it later here. But this is symbolic, in other words, a point of contact. But to sustain, you know, God told me, said, look, let me just show you. Matthew chapter 8, verse 17. He says, that it might be fulfilled. Which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare sicknesses. All right? Look at the verse before that. Verse 16. It says, when evening was come, he brought him many that were possessed of devils. He cast out the spirit with his words and healed how many? How many? All. That, next verse, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken. Which means if he didn't heal everybody, it won't be fulfilled. If he took our infirmity, then he says, look, the only way it can be fulfilled is that everybody must be healed. Look, are you telling me that everybody that came to meet Jesus was living right? Are you saying no liar came to touch him? Are you telling me everybody there was pure and holy? He healed everybody because it was an administration of body and blood. But he will tell you, go and sin no more. as we wipe this one away. And God told me, he said, it was never my plan to come down to the earth and be healing the sick, because men were not supposed to ever fall sick. That I will come with healing power, it was never my plan. He said, I took the infirmity. He said, the way I designed it is that the scripture says the spirit of a man will sustain the infirmity of his flesh. It was yours, through your own personal spirit, you heal your body. Your body is kept whole. He said, it's when that spirit is contaminated. Because the Bible says a broken spirit is what? Dryness to the bones. It's, translation says it's sickness there. Once the spirit is assaulted, and the spirit can only be kept strong if it's been eating the right what? Diet. So that's what I was doing. Feed the spirit man heals the body. Nothing on the outside. Nothing on the outside. All right? That's why he says, I will satisfy your mouth with good things so that your what? Youth is renewed as they go. He's not talking about fried rice. Do you get what I'm saying here? I've told you that. You know, the Bible says, a merry heart doeth good like medicine. So the way in which the spirit sustains the body is through joy. Because a merry heart doeth good like what? Medicine. Now, where does it get that joy there? Jeremiah chapter 15, verse 16. It says this. It says, thy words were found, and I did what? Eat them. It says, and they were joy. And that word there is manna, the real stuff. It says, they became the joy and the what? Rejoicing of my heart. And then in closing here, Proverbs 23, verse 16. It says this. Proverbs 23 and verse 16. Yea, my reins shall rejoice when my lips do what? Speak right things. So the inner man begins to rejoice. That's why if your joy goes, it's very difficult to get your body healed. Are you following what I'm saying? Very difficult to do it healed. So tonight as we go to the communion table, look at it here. That Jesus, tonight I want to partake of your very own body for complete healing of my own body. All right? As they ate the flesh of the lamb and applied the blood. Listen, you talk to Christians, you know that they discern the blood, but they don't discern the body. You know? Get Christians together. Say the blood. People will say, the blood, the blood. Get word into it. They don't, eating that one is not part of, is if you tell them, stand up now and say, the blood, everybody, particularly in Africa here, will be shouting the blood. But when it comes to eating, people, if you give them, they will sleep. Give them a book on positive thinking, they'll be reading it. Shoe bread. Get a real theological book, they'll start sleeping. Manna is hard. Shoe bread. Raise message to a level, people will say, we don't understand. I'm telling you, it's shoe bread. Why is it that, who was saying it? Was he saying it? Who said it yesterday? I even thought Wapek started yesterday. The anointings have been so strong that it looks like we have been here for 3 days. Well, was Pastor Kingsley. Who even said that with the more Christians we're having, there is no change that is happening? Huh? Pastor King. Because most of what people are eating in churches is shoe bread. In fact, nobody must be offended. Look, let me tell you. You are not a member of a church until they've offended you there and you stayed. You are not. Somebody is not your pastor until he has made a decision you don't like and you stayed. That's the proof of pastor. I won't call the person's name, but there was somebody inside the church who was a worship leader. A great man of God today, many years ago, told the person something. The The person said, I don't agree with you. He told somebody, because the person came to this church, and the person said, listen, go and tell what you did. That guy is going to cause trouble inside this church. He said, because I told him this, and he said, I don't agree. He said, it was when he said it, I knew I was not his pastor. I said, you can go. And so we are gathering people where congregation is controlling leader. Do you get what I'm saying? And that can't last. Chastisement of God is grievous, but you'll be in subjection unto the Father of spirits. It's when you are like that, that you can start getting glimpses of real manner. Because what no man's eye has seen, ear heard, heart conceived, God has prepared, not for those he loves, but for those that do what? Love him. The other one is the one is for those he loves. You know, he said, we preach these things. He says, but we speak the wisdom of God among them that are what? So let me tell you to do something. Mr. Adusi, can come. Let me just tell you to do something before we do the communion. If you are going through anything today, I want you for 5 minutes to lift up your hands to God and say, no grumbling, no complaining. I'm giving you what? Worship. Are you following what I'm saying here? What do you mean? Well, they told you, as I told David, they came to meet David. David was low maintenance. He fasted. Wait a minute. Fasted for the child. The child died. Fasted. When they came, he said, is the child there? He said, child has died. He put on his clothes. They said, what is this thing you are doing? He said, listen, it's called the keys of David. He says, God will open a door no man can shut. And he has shut a door no man can open. He said, what am I going to do? And he worshipped. It was when he was worshipping that God must have shown him, I have another child coming. Go back into Bathsheba. And Solomon came out. Who will David have been without Solomon? Adonijah? Absalom? Listen, hold it. If you're a true worshiper, you can never tell the full testimony of your life. Yes, sir. Listen, because you worshipped in places through things that you cannot tell any human being. Because worship is like marriage. Your nakedness is only known by God. You can't come out. When you get to that point, you will deviate. Listen, there was a prayer I prayed many years ago, about 30 years ago. I was about to say it. I said, oh boy, don't say it though. Don't say this prayer. Don't say it. I was not even a Christian when I prayed it, and God answered me in 24 hours. I was in secondary school. Because if you tell people, it's between you and what? God. That's, you are naked before God and not ashamed. Are you following what I'm saying here? It is those things. Because there are many Christians carrying things. What if, what if, what if? What if, what if? What if? All right? Just like we heard today, you are supposed to marry somebody. You didn't marry the person. The person has gone. The person is married. You can't be in regret. The only thing you can do is thank God you didn't marry the person. You, from the message you have heard, you found out that that's the person you should have married. But I thank God at that point. That's the only way you can handle it. And watch God bring it out. Are you going to come and tell the doctor and say, let me tell you this. What I'm trying to tell you was that there was somebody I was supposed to get married to. I went to a meeting and can you be talking like that? Are you following what I'm saying? So don't let any message bring you under condemnation. Do you get what I'm saying? Anything done in ignorance is ignorance. All right? Take it to God and turn to him in worship and say, Lord, my belly is not my God. My belly is not my God. I open my heart to you at this point and I worship you. And after I do that, which means after you do that, then the breaking of bread elements, everybody has it? Then we'll pray over it, you partake of it and allow the healing power of Jesus Christ to go on the inside of you. Does anybody not have the healing? No, hold it. There must be order here. Anybody who doesn't have, put up your hand. There's no need for fight. All right? People who don't have, please, just keep your hand up and please give it to them. Let's just take a song here All right. Let's all be seated. No matter how strong it is, sit. Okay? No matter who is doing you, just sit and worship. All right? While you are seated. Covenant says that a stranger cannot partake of the Passover. That was the instruction. So if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, and you are not born again, please, let's just be quiet, all heads bowed and eyes closed, please. You are not born again, you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. You may have been going to church, you may have even received communion in your church in the past, but you don't have any personal relationship with Jesus where you have confessed him as your personal Lord and Savior. And you want to do that, whether you are online or in this building. And you want to do that at this particular moment before you go to the table there of the covenant. I want to give you that opportunity to do that with all heads bowed and eyes closed. If you are in this auditorium, I'll make the confession also for those on the outside, and you want this prayer offered up unto you with all heads bowed, lift up your right hand wherever you are. Right? All heads bowed and eyes closed. If there's anybody here you don't know Jesus, God bless you. Any other person here? Any other person here? God bless you for that hand. Any other, God bless you for that hand. Any other, God bless you for that hand. Any other person, God bless you for that hand over there. All right, those of you who put up your hand, just put it on your chest here.
as a point of contact. And if you're at home, you're watching online, please also. And we will all make this declaration. And you consciously make this declaration, this confession with me. So let's all do it. Father, I believe in my heart that you sent Jesus to die for my sins. On the third day, you raised him up from the dead for my justification. I confess Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. I am born again. I am a child of God, delivered from the power of darkness and translated into God's kingdom. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. Those of you that put up your right hand, please. No, you come forward. All right. Put it up so they can see. Now, if you're outside, please just come to the altar and they will be holding this sign, altar call, up, and they will pray for you and do things. All right, Father. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray over and declare that we come to partake of your body with the worth associated with it, and to partake and to drink of that blood, knowing that without your flesh and without your blood, we have no life on the inside of us. As your people partake of the bread here, let it be infused with the life and power that is in the very body of Jesus in the resurrected state. Use this as a point of contact to administer healing into the bodies of every single person under the sound of my voice, that as they eat of this bread here, the very flesh of Jesus enters into their bloodstream, driving out all forms of ailment and disease and rectifying their bodies and putting them in perfect wholeness. As we partake of the cup, the contents, the blood, purge and wipe out the slate of everybody clean. Let it be that a new life started today at Wolfbeck, a life that is free of condemnation, free of judgment, free to enter. And let it be that before this month ends, that the people will have entered into something that shows the judgment has been broken, the curse has been broken, condemnation has been lifted, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Let's partake of the body here. All right. And also drink of the blood.
Yeah.
thank you for this first day of Wolfbeck. We feel so full and loaded. We return all the praise and glory unto you. Thank you for your mighty visitation upon us. We give you praise and thanks. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.